The Lord be with you. Welcome to worship this morning that we are given the opportunity and the honor to worship either at home or here in the sanctuary. And also, we want to say happy Father's Day to those of you who are here who are fathers, and also to uncles and those who are fathering to the children in their midst, even as you show church father grace here in the pews. And of course, we remember those who are grieving for their fathers, or fathers who are grieving, or those who have had difficult relationships with their father. Because ultimately today, we are here to worship our Father in heaven, who shows no partiality and calls us all children of God. So let us now breathe in the very breath of God. And allow our God to call us into this very sacred time.
Please stand if you're able and join me in the call to worship. Let your light shine. Let your hearts shine. God is faithful to us, and God rules in love. Then let us worship God.
Before Carol starts the hymn, I just wanted to say that I chose this hymn because I knew we would be singing this at camp. You might know that Jed Otterson, as a volunteer, was at camp all week. And I volunteered all week, and Charlotte, these girls' cousin, she was at camp, and all four of my children, Hannah, Jerry, Annabelle, and Daisy, and my mother were all there. So I chose this because this is a camp song, so the children and those young at heart can also follow along with the motions that I'm going to be doing up here. Thank you, Carol. Sorry.
People of God, we come to the portion in this service where we confess our sins and practice truth-telling, acknowledging that we need God's Spirit in our lives. Let us confess our sins together to the God of the early church and the God of the here and now. God of grace, you call us to a new community where opponents are reconciled. The status quo is overturned, the outcasts are restored, and the empty overflow. Yet we often prefer the old order of things, our familiar privileges, our familiar homogeneity, our familiar comfort zones. and we remain stagnant. Forgive us, O God, by your Spirit. Restore our hearts and renew our vision that we might follow Jesus with joy. Amen.
People of God, hear this good news. Despite our failings, God is here. And God has poured out God's Spirit on all flesh. We are united, we are made clean, and we are free to dream new dreams for this broken world. Thanks be to God. God has forgiven us in Christ, let us then forgive one another and pass the peace of Christ to each other. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all, those who are here in the building and those who are worshiping with us now or later on the internet. Peace be with you.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Almighty God, in you are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Open our eyes that we may see the wonders of your word. Give us grace that we may clearly understand and freely choose the way of your wisdom. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The first scripture lesson comes from the book of Psalms, chapter 9, verses 9 through 20. Listen now for the word of God. The Lord is a stronghold for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble. And those who know your name put their trust in you. For you, O Lord, have not forsaken those who seek you. Sing praises to the Lord who dwells in Zion. Declare his deeds among the peoples. For he who avenges blood is mindful of them. He does not forget the cry of the afflicted. Be gracious to me, O Lord. See what I suffer from those who hate me. You are the one who lifts me up from the gates of death, so that I may recount all your praises. And in the gates of daughter Zion, rejoice in your deliverance. The nations have sunk in the pit that they made, in the net that they had hid their own foot between, in the net that they had hid has their own foot been caught. The Lord has made himself known. He has executed judgment. The wicked are snared in the word in the work of their hands. The wicked shall depart to Sheol, all the nations that forget God. For the needy shall not always be forgotten, nor the hope of the poor perish forever. Rise up, O Lord, do not let mortals prevail. Let the nations be judged before you. Put them in fear, O Lord. Let the nations know that they are the only human. Word of God, the people of God.
Thank you. Thank you, Katie, for reminding us of God of the ages who has been with us. Our gospel lesson this morning comes from the gospel according to Mark. We've been in the gospel of Mark and we will remain there for the summer. And if you have been following on the app, if you've downloaded the Chosen app and have started to watch that, why, it just brings the story of the calling of the disciples and the disciples interacting with Jesus and the disciples' reality of life, the fear that they live in as, you know, living under, as being occupied by the Romans. Some of these things, it really comes to life and makes the story of the gospel that much more real. So when we talk about the disciples being fearful in the boat, these emotions really come to life when you watch. And I thank you, Andrea, for turning me on to that. And when I saw Jolene Jackson was worshiping with us at the 8 a.m. service, and she's been watching The Chosen as well. Has anybody else downloaded the app? Laura has. Okay. So as we go through the summer, then more and more of us might be watching it. So here we are, Mark 4, verses 35 to 41. On that day, when evening had come, he said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat so that the boat was already being swamped. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" He woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Then the wind ceased and there was a dead calm. He said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" This is the word of the Lord. One of the reasons that I appreciate the show, The Chosen, is that you see within these disciples, as they are being called and as they begin to follow Jesus, and as they have conversations amongst themselves, as they come to the knowledge of who Jesus is, some of them more ready to accept his being the Messiah, and some less ready. Why, this story, of course, as they are filled with awe, and they ask each other, "Who is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" For there were ancient Near Eastern myths that these disciples would have known about the divine being able to have power over the wind and the sea. There was this thought of this great sea monster, the dragon of the depths, and that the divine could slay this dragon. Why, there he was right in front of them. And you know, I don't know about you, but I have sometimes in the past read this scripture and felt a little bit of a twinge of a shame. Like, oh yeah, I'm just like those disciples having no faith. But did you notice? It wasn't the disciples that he rebuked. What did he rebuke? He rebuked the wind and the sea. He just turned to them and said, "Have you still no faith?" Which of course has an understanding that there's going to be more faith to come. I like to think of this story as our own journey of faith, which I say very often doesn't just start right here and end there, right? That we have this journey that ebbs and flows. We have this journey of being invited into the boat. Do you remember who first told you about God? Do you remember receiving your calling into the Christian life? It's not just pastors that have a calling, right? Each one of us has that time that maybe we can remember of first, maybe it was your confirmation when you stood before the congregation and accepted this identity as a Christian, or maybe a baptism as a young adult. Maybe it was a time at church camp where you recognize the presence of God. Charlotte and I got to watch with the rest of the camp, or her camp group, we watched Sister Act. How many of you know that? The movie. And, you know, Sister Mary Clarence, she's there undercover because she's in danger, so she has to pretend like she's a nun. And all the other nuns ask her, when did you receive your calling, Mary Clarence? And she kind of had to make something up. Well, you don't have to make something up. Had there been times in your life, maybe there was the first time, or maybe there was a time of renewal of faith, to say, wow, I have really distanced myself from God and my faith life, and I'm feeling called back into the reading of scriptures and feeling called back into a life of prayer. Why, I compare this getting into the boat with Jesus, that time of that calling, either that first calling or that renewal of faith, and we get in the boat and we're excited, right? Sign me up, maybe we say. Sign me up for this Bible study. Sign me up to serve in the soup kitchen. Sign me up to come every Sunday. And maybe there was a time where it was sign me up and I'll press play on this computer and I will worship God. And so those disciples, they were probably really excited, but maybe they were a bit fearful too. Why did he want just them to come on the boat with him? They were with the crowd, and he was teaching the crowd, and then he singled them out and said, hey, we're going to go over to the other side. Well, what's on the other side? Maybe you remember first walking in, maybe it was this church that you walked into, or maybe another church. You had said all week, I'm finally going to go. And maybe there was a little bit of fear of, well, what's going to be on the other side? Will anyone say hello? Will I know what to do? Will I know when to stand and when to sit down? Will I feel the presence of God? When we enter new situations, maybe when we cross barriers, maybe we go to a church where no one looks like us, but we know that that is our calling to cross racial barriers and boundaries, to do that because of Christ. Maybe we're a little bit of afraid, but we do it because we are called. So there on the boat, there we are in our journey of faith. And then can you feel the boat rocking? It's not just rocking like I experienced once when I took one of those boats that go from Michigan to Wisconsin. I went from Muskegon over to Milwaukee, and it was rocking so much. There wasn't any danger, but it was rocking so much I couldn't stay in the belly of the boat or else I would have lost my lunch. And so I had to sit up top. But it wasn't just that for the disciples, right? There was water coming in. It said, indeed, they were being swamped. It was scary. They were frightened. They were disappointed, too. And this is part of our journey of faith. We walk in with open eyes and maybe a little bit of naivete, and we walk in, and then all of a sudden things are crashing around us, and we shake our fists and say, where are you, God? I know I've done that. Have you? When the storm of grief, the storm of disappointment, disappointment in self, or maybe disappointment in others, disappointment in the church, or maybe even disappointment in God, and we raise our fists and, like those disciples, say, "Where are you? We're perishing." I know I think it was like April of last year, I called Mike and said, "I just need to ask you, do you feel like our reality is really, really strange and scary right now? Because I needed to know that someone else felt that way too." And we talked for a little bit, and then we both decided that the good question to ask, like my spiritual director used to ask me, was, "Where is God in all of this?" Because denying God's presence in this very strange reality, where there was even a curfew in our town, that was even scarier. And so we decided that even if we didn't know the answer of where was God, even asking, "Where are you, God?" felt like we were a little bit more firmly planted, looking for God. Charlotte was also part of a process last Saturday where the kids were learning to pray as they were working toward attaining their prayer milestone. And one of the ways to pray is to ask God for God's insight. The old ancient way was even to ask God for God's eyes. Well, certainly we can't have God's eyes and see exactly how God sees the world, but we can ask God, "Where are you? Can you show us a bit of your wisdom?" And that's what they were asking. "Where are you? Why are you sleeping?" And we ask that too. And sometimes we clap our hands when we finally hear from our God, feel and know God's presence. That's why we come back here week after week, even if we're not feeling God's presence. For John Wesley said that even if we're not completely feeling and believing, we come and worship anyway, because one day God will meet us. And so then I love how it just goes from their anger and then just Jesus standing up, waking up, and rebuking the waves. Our God does rebuke the sin and the evil in our world. For sin is described as that which separates us from God, the things that separate us from each other. Our God is rebuking those and is calling us to rebuke those. That's why we pray this congregational prayer, collective prayer of confession. And so we name those things that we know our God will rebuke, is rebuking. We name the racism in our nation as we celebrated yesterday, Juneteenth, the day that in our nation we can celebrate that all were freed. Our God is rebuking everything that separates us from one another in our relationships, that which separates us from ourselves, the shame and the guilt. It's helpful for me when I feel encumbered and overwhelmed by the sin and the pain of our world. It's helpful for me to imagine our God rebuking that and saying, "Peace, be still." One of the ways that I think we as people are given the opportunity to be still and to have peace is to be surrounded by God's great nature. And Charlotte, if you're ready to speak this morning, you can, but I will tell you that the others are not here. Okay, that's fine. But you do get a gold star because the others who went to camp aren't here right now. But we did discuss this week, the curriculum was all about creation. And the final day was this reminder that God rested on the final day. And through enjoying nature and acknowledging the beauty of it, we can be given this peace and this stillness even within our own souls. And like I said, Jesus doesn't rebuke the disciples. When he offers them peace, he just maybe gives a forecast that their faith will grow. And so this is a continual journey. We get on the boat, we get excited, and there may be waves, there may be things crashing, and our God calms us in ways that God can. And maybe then we dive off the boat and leave for a little while. But then we get back on to study more, to learn more, to experience the peace of God, even in the midst of our own turmoil and grief, to experience that peace and to allow our faith to grow through the reading of Scripture and through our worshiping. So, my dear friends, I invite you onto the boat, even if it is rocking a bit, even if it is a bit swampy, because the most important piece is that God is there and God remains sovereign and God offers us that peace and that stillness that is beyond anything that the world can offer. May it be true. Amen. And you don't have to stand for the hymn, because we've been standing for the hymn, and then we have to stand for the affirmation of faith, and I feel really bad about that, so we can sit.
Thank you.
Please stand if you are able and join me in the affirmation in faith. We believe and confess only one God, who can do all things, is all wise, all good, all just, and all merciful. We believe that everything required for our salvation has been offered and communicated to us in Jesus Christ, the wisdom of God and God's eternal Son. Jesus Christ clothed himself in our flesh, God and human in one person. We believe that we are illuminated in faith by the unfathomable grace of the Holy Spirit. God imparts this gracious gift by faith received in the holy lives in awe and reverence for God. For we receive what the gospel promises when God gives us the Holy Spirit. Amen.
And while we are not passing the plate, but we are welcome to put our offering in as we come in or as we leave, or also you are welcome to use the PayPal link that you can find on our website. This specific time during the music, we are given the opportunity to meditate upon the giving of our gifts, the ways in which we have received from the giving of gifts, and the ways in which we are offering our own sacrifice to give of our own selves. Let us now respond to God's good word by giving of our gifts and our talents.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, we thank you for the ways in which you have blessed us. We thank you for these gifts that have been given with sacrifice and with joy and hope. And we ask that you will continue to call us as a congregation to know just how to use these gifts to live into your calling as we share your love, as we welcome, worship, celebrate, and serve. It is in your name that we pray. Amen. So as far as concerns of the church, as I mentioned before, there were five children and three adults, including my mother, who embarked upon the journey of church camp this week. And so next week, we'll be hearing from Jed, our young adult, who was a volunteer counselor. And we'll be hearing from Charlotte and Hannah and Jerry and Annabelle and Daisy, all about their experience at church camp. So look forward to their reflections, because they will be very wise and prophetic. Also, speaking of kids and education, whether online, hybrid, or in person, or inside or outside, these are our dates for VBS. Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, July 20th, 21st, and 22nd. And we'll be making decisions very soon to be able to tell you exactly just how we will be experiencing Vacation Bible School this summer. I think those are my only... Oh, the last concern of the church. We did have an insert last week about the Footlight Players show that will be this Friday night, Saturday, and Sunday. Penny, it will be in it, and Laura is directing. And also, Apostle Vera Roberts from the Deliverance and Victory Church. Many other churches who are part of her Pentecostal group in this area will be having worship Friday night and Saturday night and Sunday after our worship. So please consider being part of any of those worship experiences. And if you want to hear more about that, please come talk to me. I think those are the only concerns of the church. And so now we can respond to God now with the sacrifice of our prayers. Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, we do thank you for your creation. And as the kids and adults studied this week about your creation and the beauty within it, we ask that you might give us moments to have peace and to be still within your creation, to have awe and wonder like those disciples had there in the boat when you, in the form of Jesus the Christ, did calm the wind and the waves. Gracious God, we ask that you might continue to call us into this journey onto your boat of this faithful life. And gracious God, we continue to call out to you. Call out to you and ask for your presence, your wisdom, your healing in places where there is need of your presence, wisdom, and healing all over this world. And gracious God, we do pray for our nation. Our nation, which just celebrated the Juneteenth holiday. And we ask that you might keep us ever mindful of the significance of this holiday. Ever mindful of the ways in which we have been separated and are separated, and the ways in which you are calling us to move beyond barriers. Gracious God, we do pray for our nation, and we ask for your divine discernment to be with our nation's leaders. We pray for our community. We pray for our worshiping community. We pray the prayers that have been lifted this morning. We pray for Louise Derflinger, for Sally Hooper, for Chris Winninger, and Bill Winfield. We pray for Margot Schenck and her entire family as they grieve for the loss of her mother, Betty. We ask that you be with Margot, and Pam, and Riley, Aiden, and Mikey, and all of their family as they are grieving. And may we know as a congregation just how to surround them with our love. We pray for Debbie's brother, Jerry. And we thank you that Barb Vinson is continuing to recover from surgery. We give you thanks for the birth of one of our MOPS' new baby, Jack. And we also pray for two other MOPS who will be giving birth this summer. We pray for Katie, and thank you for her talent that she shared with us this morning. And we pray for Juji, who also will be having a baby. We ask that you will, again, help our congregation to know just how to support these families. We pray for our congregation and our military and their families, and our AmeriCorps and Peace Corps workers and their families. And we continue to pray for our world as a world we continue to navigate the COVID-19 pandemic. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now let us go from this place, entering that boat of faith, allowing our God to offer us peace and stillness. Let us go from this place in the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the compassion of the Holy Spirit, both now and forevermore. Amen, and go in peace.